Last month was yet again another G20 Interfaith Forum meeting. What that means is when all the religious leaders from various denominations and even various religions come together and meet together prior to the G20 meeting of the world leaders. This was in the month of June 2019. We would like to once again, as we have done in time past, to look at what a little bit of what is the interfaith or G20 interfaith forum, and we also want to look at what is their agenda. Should Seventh-day Adventists be involved, be sending representative to these events? Notice with me carefully on the screen what this says here. The G20 Interfaith Forum, why it's important. This was from the Georgetown University Berkeley Center for Religion, Peace and World Affairs, June 27, 2019. Now, as we look at this, and the next articles we're going to be looking at, the G20 Interfaith Forum and the G20 leaders of the world meetings there is none other than Revelation chapter 13 being fulfilled. Church and state coming together. The religions came together last month and to dictate to the world leaders behind the scene what they need to address, the things that they need to tackle. Again, keep Revelation chapter 13 in mind. The image of the beast. Back to the screen. It goes on to say, the G20 Interfaith Forum reflects a remarkable partnership. Keyword there, partnership. Crossing continents, cultures, disciplines, ideologies, and religious traditions. This year's G20 summit held in Osaka, Japan, the G20 is a special forum, a time and place where powerful, here it is, leaders and nations can respond and act. So you see a distinction there. G20, that's the meeting of the powerful world leaders. The G20 Interfaith Forum, that's the representative of the various religions that came together prior to the secular leaders meet to tackle world issues. And again, it is the religious leaders that meet first behind the scene and that dictate to the religious or to the secular leaders what they need to do, what they need to address, what they need to tackle. Back to the screen. It goes on to say, we there is the interfaith forum leaders, the religion. We challenge them and are mobilizing to respond and help shape agendas. Why is an interfaith voice important for the G20? An attention-catching statistic suggests that, notice carefully the answer, 84% of the world's people have a religious affiliation, faith traditions, mobilize communities. So here is one of the reasons why they gave, why the world leaders should listen to the faith leaders. Now, we are talking about ecumenism here. We are talking about, when we say ecumenism, we are talking about the various denominations and religions coming together based on, quote unquote, John chapter 17, that they all may be one. And that oneness they are talking about, lay aside your differences, lay aside your belief, and come together because we all worship the same God. It doesn't matter if that God is Buddha, if that God is Allah, it doesn't matter. We worship the same God, so lay aside all of this and come together and let's tell the leaders of the world what they need to tackles. Notice with me. It goes on to say, same article. 17, notice another agenda, 17 sustainable development goals that all UN member countries approved in 2015 with a demanding set of 169 targets, set deadlines and accountability that are truly global in scope. The SDGs, that's the Sustainable Development Goals, are a continuing agenda for us all, as well as for the G20. Notice carefully when it says this is an agenda for us all, the us all is talking about this interfaith group, the religions that come together. It is also an agenda for the G20 secular leaders. Back to the screen. They represent the Sustainable Development Goals, the 17. They represent an overall framework, a global architecture and agenda. Notice carefully. Religious actors engage on each and every goal and target. So again, here is another agenda of this gathering, the G20 Interfaith Forum, as the religions, as the religious leaders come together. What's the agenda there? To push, to tell the secular leaders to implement, to adapt, to enforce the UN 17 Sustainable Development Goals, which, as we covered before, this is a diabolical agenda. This is a population control agenda. And also, this is a Sunday law disguising as a quote-unquote, helping the poor, helping the planet. Let's get some more information. Back to the screen. It says here, from Interfaith 20, Forum 2019, the G20 Interfaith Forum is a platform, notice carefully, for raising the level and effectiveness of religious inputs and providing a sharp focus on values, on global policy issues, bringing together global leaders and experts from religion, civil society, government, and academia. This year's forum will focus on issues vital to, notice carefully, security and well-being, including refugees, cross-cultural tensions, health, children, aging societies, and what else? And care for the earth. Does that sound like the Pope agenda? Care for the earth. And what's the best way, once again, to care for the earth? Is to keep Sunday. Keep that in mind. But as we see this gathering of these religious leaders and secular leaders bringing together or coming together to create this image of the beast, at that moment in time, based on the three angels' messages, what does the Bible says in verse 7 of Revelation 14? It says, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come, and worship him who made heaven and earth, the sea and the fountains of waters. In other words, the Bible tells us, as we see this image of the beast being created, as we read in Revelation chapter 13, this is the time for us to be contending for the faith. Notice with me on the screen what Paul says to Timothy. 1 Timothy 1 verse 3. He says, as I besought thee to abide still at Ephesus when I went into Macedonia, that thou mightest charge some. What's the charge? That they teach no other doctrine. The interfaith, this ecumenical movement taking place, that has been taking place for many years now, that Seventh-day Adventist General Conference is deeply involved in. This is a push, as mentioned before. They use John 17 to say that all may be one, as Christ says, but they may be one in unity, to unite together. It doesn't matter, once again, if Buddha is your God, if Mohammed is your God, if that stone over there is your God. If Jehovah is your God, just come together in unity. Can there be unity with paganism? Can there be unity with those who are fighting against God? Can there be unity with those who do not want to have anything to do with our loving Savior, Jesus Christ? Can there be unity with them? This is the reason why Paul again says, I charge thee, Timothy, that you teach no other doctrine. The movement, the interfaith movement, the ecumenical movement, is a movement to lay aside your doctrine and adopt and embrace the doctrine, the teachings of the papacy, which is the wine of Babylon. This is what the Bible tells us. Go to the book of Revelation with me. Revelation chapter 18. Let's look at Revelation chapter 18 quickly. This is the wine of Babylon. The wine there is the teaching or the doctrine of Babylon. Notice carefully. The Bible tells us in verse 2 of Revelation 18, and the angel in verse 1 cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen and is become the habitation of devils and the hold of every foul spirit and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird. For all nations have, what is it, drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornications. And the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her. The kings of the earth have joined Babylon in ecumenical movement. Notice, it goes on to say, and the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies. So the coming together as one and quote-unquote lay aside the differences. This is ecumenical movement. This is the wine of Babylon. Go to chapter 17. The Bible also says, notice carefully, it says in verse 13 of chapter 17, these have one mind and shall give their power and strength unto the beast. Who is the beast? We're talking about Babylon. We're talking about the papacy. So this, again, gathering of the religions and the denominations, the quote-unquote Christian denominations, is to lay aside what God's word says and to adapt, to embrace the teachings of Babylon. Notice next passage here from Jude 3. It says here, Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the coming salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that, notice carefully, ye should earnestly do what? Contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. We cannot contend for the faith if we are merging, if we are meeting, if we are uniting with Babylon. That is very contrary to Revelation chapter 18. Verse 1 again. And after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. Now, this angel again is a messenger. This angel again is God's people in these last days. These peculiar people having a distinct message, a powerful message, a message of disunity with Babylon, because we just read in verse 2 and then going down to verse 3, verse 4, it says they cried out with a loud voice. What? Babylon is fallen. And what's they call? Because Babylon is fallen, because Babylon have made all the nations, all the denominations drunk of the wine of her fornication, what's the call? In verse 4, come out of her, my people. So it's not a message of unity. Again, we cannot unite with Babylon. We cannot unite with the fallen religions based on quote-unquote unity. Can there be such a unity when they are worshiping other gods? But unfortunately, notice with me on the screen here. You can see to the bottom left of your screen, many of you know who this is. And you can see his name there. This is Diop Ganune, Director of Public Affairs and Religious Liberty for Seventh-day Adventist Church, Maryland, USA. He is one of the keynote speakers at the G20 Interfaith Forum meetings, as he has been doing for many times. Let's read one more time part of the Interfaith Forum G20 agenda. Notice carefully. It says, the G20 Interfaith Forum offers an annual platform where a network of religiously linked institutions and initiatives engage on global agendas, primarily and including, again, the Sustainable Development Goals, or SDGs. The annual G20 summits are a critical time and place where priority global issues are considered. The G20 process has evolved since it was established in 2008, with various platforms, ministerial meetings, engagement groups that allow different sectors and communities to present ideas and recommendations to whom? To global leaders. The G20 Interfaith Forum builds on the vital roles that religious institutions and beliefs play in world affairs, reflecting their rich diversity of institutions, ideas, and values. In other words, again, Revelation 13, verses 12, 13, and 14, the image of the beast, church and state uniting. And who is there? Who is one of the main speakers? As a matter of fact, not just one of the keynote speakers. He is an agent for the papacy. He is the chief architect of bringing the religions together under the umbrella of the papacy. I'm speaking of Ganune Diop. Next article here. Notice on the screen. It says here, from Advent Messenger, July 2nd, 2019, top Adventist leaders share religious panel with whom? With Jesuit pioneer, interreligious Muslim, and ecumenical evangelical. Now you have two Adventist leaders meeting with whom? With the Jesuits. What business do we have meeting with the Jesuits? As Seventh-day Adventists, knowing what we know about the Jesuits, what's their agenda? What's their goal? The goal of the Jesuits is to annihilate Protestantism, is to get rid of Protestantism and to bring back the supremacy of the papacy. That's the goal of the Jesuits. We have a book called Great Controversy that explains, that tell us the agendas of the Jesuits. Plus, we have a Jesuit Pope. Now, what's this unification about? Let's ask the question, can Rome change? Verse 1 of Revelation chapter 13. Notice, the Bible tells us in Revelation chapter 13, and I stood upon the sand of the sea and saw a beast rise up out of the sea. That's the papacy, having seven heads and 10 horns, and upon his horns, 10 crowns, and upon his heads, the name of blasphemy. And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard. And the Bible asks the question, can the leopard change its spots? No, it will never change. The same agenda that the Jesuits had way back then, it's the same agenda today. They have not changed. But yet we find a Seventh-day Adventist leader, well, two of them, meeting with the Jesuits. And this was not the first time. Notice next article here. Well, same article goes on to say, from left to right, Bishop Gunnar Stolset, Jesuit sister Dennis Golan, Mohammed Abu Nimr, Adventist Ganune Diop, and Adventist Jonathan Duffy at the 2019 G20 Interfaith Forum in Chiba, Japan on Saturday, June 8th, 2019. Now, let me say this, and I'm going to say it one more time. This individual by the name of Ganune Diop, he is the brother of all these, those Jesuits. Adventists, true Adventists, are not his brothers and sisters. The Jesuits are. Notice, back to the screen again. Notice, interfaith form, concept paper. Notice carefully. The 2019 form agenda will address three principal topic areas. What are they? Peace and security. Pause. What does the Bible say about peace and security? When they say peace and safety or security, what happened? Then sudden destruction comes upon them. At this time, when we are seeing the events that are transpiring in our world, as students of Bible prophecy, what should our leaders be doing at this time? Proclaiming, sounding the three angels' messages, sounding the trumpet. Give the trumpet a certain sound. But we see many of our leaders, what are they doing? Instead of calling a people of out of Babylon, they are meeting with Babylon, giving the trumpet an uncertain sound. Back to the screen. Notice, let's read again. 2019 form agenda will address three principal topic areas, peace and safety, including action to address the challenges posed by refugee movements and migration, corruption, violence, and efforts to cultivate social cohesion and respect for difference in societies. Do you notice here what kind of organization now the General Conference is? It's just a social organization. It's not about preaching the three angels' messages. They are preaching Revelation 16 counterfeit three angels' messages. You have the dragon, the beast, and the false prophet. That's a message. That's the message for this time. It's a message that the General Conference is proclaiming unity. Revelation 14, verses 6 through all the way down through verse 12 tells us there is no such thing as a unity message with Babylon in these last days. Back to the screen again. Notice carefully one more time. It says here, part of the agenda is respect for difference in society. I'll come back to this. People, meaning the vital issues for human welfare and well-being, with special emphasis on children, roles of women and men, health, education, and the phenomenon of aging societies and planet, care for the earth, and actions needed to protect the environment and address the challenges posed by climate change. Again, do you see the Sunday law agenda here within this G20 interfaith agenda? Yes. And who is helping them to promote this, to push for this? Diop Ganuni or Ganun Diop. Now, let's go back to the red words at the top. It says here, and respect for difference in society. Can we have respect for the Antichrist? What did we just read in chapter 18 of the Revelation? God shows no respect for Babylon. God described here in chapter 18 the sins of Babylon, the condition of Babylon. And God is calling a people to sound the alarm, to blow the trumpet against Babylon and call a people out of Babylon. But now we're talking about respect for Babylon. Notice with me what Spirit of Prophecy tells us here. It says, the religion of Jesus is endangered. It is being mangled with who? With worldliness. Worldly policy is taking the place of the true piety and wisdom that comes from above. And God will do what? Remove his prospering hand from where? From the conference. Shall the Ark of the Covenant be removed from the people? From these people? Shall idols be smuggled in? Shall false principles and false precepts be brought into the sanctuary? Shall Antichrist be respected? This is directly where the enemy, through blinded and consecrated men, is leading us. So the last question that Spirit of Prophecy asks there, shall Antichrist be respected? And as you look at this picture here, again, from the Interfaith 20 meeting, Keep in mind the question again. Shall the Antichrist be respected? At the top there, what do you see? Messages to the phone from religious leaders. And who's one of those religious leaders? That is Pope Francis. And down below, whom do we see here as the main speaker and panelist? Dio Ganuni. The question was asked again. Shall the Antichrist be respected? Yes, brothers and sisters. It's the same thing. Again, remember, he went to Rome. And what did he do? He went to the Vatican. What did he do? Shake hands with the papacy. Brothers and sisters, as Sister White says here, go back to the screen again, latter part there. Last question, shall Antichrist be respected? Then she says, this is directly where the enemy, through blinded, unconsecrated men, is leading us. So if those men are blind, should we follow them? Should we continue to support them? What does the Bible say? If the blind lead the blind, what would happen? They both will fall into the ditch. We should not be following this. Again, as I said before, this man, Dio Ganuni, is either a Jesuit himself or he just loves his Jesuit brothers. Because, as we looked at before, a few months ago, he went to Rome, just a block away from the Vatican, and he met with the Jesuits at the Jesuit headquarters, where the Jesuits take their oath how they will strangle, boil, and kill anybody who would dare to stand in opposition to their agendas. Let me play for you this video that shows the area, that particular building there, where the Jesuits meet, and Pope Francis was also there. Notice carefully.
Today, Monday, October 24th, at the invitation of the Jesuit Curia in Rome, Pope Francis joined the Jesuits of the 36th General Congregation for a morning of prayer and conversation. He was greeted by the new Jesuit leader, Father General Arturo Sosa, and the superior of the Jesuit Curia, Father Joaquin Barrero. He made his way upstairs to the aula, the large hall where the Jesuits have been working all these weeks, and was greeted with thunderous applause and cheerful admiration. Once the room was settled and the Jesuits took their place, the musicians played instrumental music to set the tone for the special morning prayer service. Hymns were sung and intentions in various languages were voiced for Pope Francis and the Church. At the conclusion of their morning praise, all the men recited the Our Father and sang together Ad Maiorem Dei Gloria. At the conclusion of his speech, the Holy Father joined Father General and the Jesuit delegates for a large group photo. A photo that will historically capture this special day when the first Jesuit Pope comes to a Jesuit General Congregation.
That same area you just saw in the picture, that same room there, again, that's where the Jesuits take their oath, how they will do whatever it takes to bring the papacy back to power. Now, where is the Pope standing according to this picture here? You notice it is in that same room. Where is Dio Ganuni? Notice carefully. In the same room as the Pope, and to the left of that screen, you could see the head of the Jesuits there on his knees taking his oath or something like that, and you have the crucifix, and you have a Seventh-day Adventist leader meeting there with the Jesuits. How in the world did he get out of that room without any harm, anything? How did that happen? It's because he's not a Seventh-day Adventist. It's because he's one of them. That's the reason why he was able to come out of that room. Go to the book of Revelation chapter 14 with me. Revelation chapter 14. Notice with me what the Word of God says in chapter 14. Notice carefully with me as I read this passage for you. In Revelation chapter 14, again, beginning in verse 9, is the warning from receiving the mark of the beast all the way down to verse 11. Let's read. And the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation, and he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever, and they shall have no rest day nor night, who worship the beast and his image, and whosoever receiveth the mark of the beast. Now, which group here this is referring to? Because God has already said in verse 8 of the same chapter that Babylon is falling, is falling, is falling. I want you to pay closely attention to what I'm about to read for you to understand that this passage here is referring to the apostate Protestantism, whether if it's the General Conference or the Methodists or the Baptists that follow the papacy, that are in unity with the papacy. Notice carefully with me what it says here from Great Controversy 382. Babylon is said to be the what? The mother of harlots. But the daughters must be, by her daughters, must be symbolized churches that cling to her doctrines and traditions. This is what Revelation chapter 17 tells us, that Babylon has daughters. Remember, those daughters are Protestants. Notice with me. Notice carefully. Let's reread this again. Babylon is said to be the mother of harlots. By her daughters must be symbolized churches that cling to her doctrines and traditions and follow her example of sacrificing the truth and the approval of God in order to form an unlawful alliance with the world. So here is a very good example of Babylon's daughters. Those who sacrifice the truth and join Babylon in an unlawful alliance or unity or ecumenism or interfaith movement, when they join Babylon, they have forsaken the truth. Now they became what? Daughter to Babylon. Notice carefully. It goes on to say, the message of Revelation 14 announcing the fall of Babylon must apply, notice carefully, to religious bodies that were once pure and have become corrupt. This also applies to the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. Take note, I did not say to the Adventist Church, I said to the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists, they have become corrupt as well. Notice carefully back to the screen. Since this message follows the warning of the judgment, which we just read in verses 9 through 11, it must be given in the last days. Therefore, it cannot refer to the Rumish Church, for that church has been in a fallen condition for many centuries. So this is not referring to what we just read in Revelation chapter 14 there. It's not referring to the mother church. It's referring to the daughters. What are some of the characteristics of the daughters? How can we identify the daughters? Those two characteristics there she gave us, those daughters who have sacrificed the truth of God, lay aside the truth of God, the doctrines that make us a peculiar people, and then they have joined, number two, they have joined Babylon in this unholy alliance or unlawful alliance. That is what makes them sister to Babylon or a daughter to Babylon, the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists is corrupt. Is a sister or a daughter to Babylon. But brothers and sisters, there's a message, a clear message for us in these last days. Verse 7 of chapter 14 saying, with a loud voice, fear God and give what? Glory to Him, not to Babylon. Babylon is trying to get all the glory. But God says, give the glory to Him, for the hour of His judgment is come. Worship Him who made heaven and earth. And as also the Bible tells us in verse 12 of the same chapter, here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that do what? Keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus Christ. Then shortly after that, remember this is referring to the righteousness of Jesus Christ. The Bible tells, gives us the good news that our Lord and Savior will come in a cloud of glory with His sickle to harvest the earth. What we are seeing happening, what we just covered there, are just part of the signs of the time, brothers and sisters, that tell us our loving Savior is on His way. That tells us that soon and very soon we are going to see a small hand in a form of a cloud, small hand. Then it's gonna get bigger and bigger and brighter until we will behold, by God's grace, the face of our loving Savior, Jesus Christ. But until then, brothers and sisters, we need to be self-supported. We need to study for ourselves because these leaders will not take us, are not putting us, are not pointing to us, the Lamb of God who taketh away the sins of the world. They are going after the men of sin, that is the papacy. Let's pray. Father God in heaven, we want to thank you once again for reminding us that we are just passengers in this world. We have a mission, and we need to focus here on this mission that you have given us. Help us, Father, not to get distracted by anything. I pray, Father, for strength, for courage that you would give to your people in these last days that we would need to not only contend for the faith, but also to proclaim the final message for this final hour. We thank you for the many blessings. In Jesus' name, amen.